Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. Christ the royal master leads against the foe. Forward into battle, see his banners go. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. At the sign of triumph, Satan's host doth flee. On then, Christian soldiers, on to victory. Hell's foundations quiver at the shout of praise. Brothers, lift your voices, loud your anthems raise. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. Like a mighty army moves the church of God. Brothers, we are treading where the saints have trod. We are not divided, all one body we, one in hope and doctrine, one in charity. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. Onward then, ye people, join our happy throng, blend with ours your voices in the triumph song. Glory, Lord, and honor unto Christ the King. This through countless ages men and angels sing. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before.
Good day to you, my beloved friend. Welcome to the old landmark Missionary Baptist Bible Trail. This is the online Bible study program of Antioch Missionary Baptist Church here in Wichita, Kansas. And we are glad that you've joined us today for our Bible study. This program is designed to be a wagon train through the Word of God. It's my goal that in my life I'll be able to preach through the entire Bible. And so I'm glad that you've joined us today for that. We are in the middle of going through the Gospel of John, chapter number 6. And so we'll be opening up to that chapter here in just a few moments. But first, let's have a prayer, and then we will have another song, and then we will get into the study of the Word of God. Lord Jesus, we come to you with all of our burdens and all of our hurts and all of our needs. Lord God, you know each and every one of them. Dear God, I pray that you would be with all the prayer requests that are on the folks' hearts that are out there, both the spoken and the unspoken. Dear God, you know our burdens, you know our needs. Lord, we pray that you would be with those that are sick, those that are hurting, those that have medical problems of whatever kind, those that have this COVID-19 and are still struggling with it and its effects. Dear God, we pray. pray for our country, that you would help us to recover from this, and that you would help us to have a great revival. Lord God, be with your churches. Help them to focus on you and to draw strength from you. Dear God, be with those that are grieving the loss of loved ones, and just draw near unto them and comfort them as only you can. Dear Jesus, be with us today as we study the Bible. I pray, Lord God, that you would give me the words to speak. Help me, dear God, to expound the word to the people that are listening. Forgive us of our sins. I pray, dear God, if there's anyone listening that's not saved, they would hear the gospel and cry out to you for salvation before it's everlasting too late. All these things we ask in your name, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay. Our next hymn is number 380. Number 380. I wandered in the shades of night till Jesus came to me, and with the sunlight of his love bid all my darkness flee. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. The clouds may gather in the sky and billows round me roll, however dark the world may be, I've sunlight in my soul. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. While walking in the light of God, I sweet communion find. I press with holy vigor on and leave the world behind. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. Soon I shall see him as he is, the light that came to me. Behold the brightness of his face throughout eternity. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. Amen. Turn with me in your Bibles to the Gospel of John, chapter number 6. Gospel of John, chapter number 6, and we're picking back up in verse 38. We are in the middle of Jesus' discourse on the subject of himself as the bread of life. You'll remember that Jesus, at the beginning of this chapter, fed a great multitude of people in a great miracle. He took 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, and he fed over 5,000 people. And we saw that in response to that miracle, the people desired to take him by force and to make him a king. And Jesus, of course, was able to avoid them. We saw that he went apart into a mountain to pray, and then he had sent his disciples across the Sea of Galilee, basically telling them, I'll catch up to you. And he caught up to them by walking on the water. That was another great miracle. And the next day, that crowd of people was looking for Jesus, and they realized that somehow he'd gone across the sea, and so they got into boats, and they followed him across the Sea of Galilee, and they caught up with him. And when they found him, Jesus told them, you're not following me, you're not seeking me because you understood my miracle, because you understood what it meant. You're not following me because you want to receive, you know, Jesus is basically implying that they don't understand that he's the spiritual Messiah, the Son of Man. He makes it clear the only reason they're following him is because he fulfilled that physical need of providing them with physical bread. And you know, there's some people, they just cannot see past this world and the needs of this world. Let me tell you something, this world is temporary. This world, when we look at the big picture, does not matter. It's the world that is to come that is the most important thing. And so, you know, Jesus was telling them that, you know, they had seen, but they had not believed. And they basically told him, well, what sign will you show us that we might believe you. And that's a horrible thing for them to say, because Jesus had already worked a great miracle. And before that, he worked many other miracles. Like many of the Jews of the time, you know, the Bible says in the book of 1 Corinthians, the Jews require a sign. And it was Jesus who said, "It is a wicked and adulterous generation that seeketh after a sign." We saw that. And so Jesus, in response, they basically said, "Look, Moses gave us bread from heaven to eat." They didn't really want a different miracle. They still wanted their physical need met, but they wanted it done in a more dramatic fashion. They're like, "Hey, Jesus, you know, you gave us bread, but Moses gave us our fathers the bread from heaven while they were wandering in the wilderness for 40 years. Can you do that, Jesus?" And that was the cue that Jesus took to begin this great discourse on the bread of life. Jesus said in this chapter, "I am the bread of life." We're going to see, he says, "I'm the bread of life that came down from heaven." And we've seen through this discourse already that Jesus said to eat him as the bread of life means to come to him and to believe on him. You see, life in the Bible day, bread in the Bible days was a symbol of life because bread was literally a food that you ate every day. Bread was a sustainer of life. And that's why Jesus chooses that as a metaphor to describe himself. He says, "I am the bread of life." And then, of course, Jesus got into a discourse on the fact that if you eat him figuratively, spiritually, as the bread of life, meaning if you come to him and believe on him, we saw yesterday in John chapter number 6 and verse 37, he said, "All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out." So we saw there that Jesus was telling them both about the doctrine of election, that the Father foreknew all those who would be in Christ and gave that group of people, which is believers, to Jesus to be saved, and that everyone in that group would be saved and not one of them would be lost. Furthermore, Jesus said in that verse, "Him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out." He made it clear that he would not throw away anyone who was of the elect. He would not throw away anyone that the Father had given him. If you are saved, then you are always saved. God the Father and Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit keep you saved by their power. And then Jesus says in verse 38, "For I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me." Now, this in no way implies that Jesus does not desire to save the elect. What is under consideration in this verse is that the will of Jesus and the will of the Father are one and the same. Remember, we read, and we're going to see again today if we get to it, in John chapter number 10, Jesus said, "I and my Father are one." It is the will of God that everyone who is saved be kept. And so we read in verse 39, "And this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all which he hath given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day." You know, there in John chapter number 10 and verse 28, let's just review that real quick. We looked at it yesterday. But in John chapter number 10 and verse 28, Jesus said, "I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand." It is very clear that it was the purpose of God that of all that God the Father gave to Jesus Christ, Jesus should lose nothing. Now, what some people do is they try to ignore what Jesus said here and point to Judas and say, "Well, Judas is proof that you can lose your salvation," they say. No, he's not. We're going to see in the Gospel of John very clearly, we're even going to see in this chapter, that Judas was not a true believer. In fact, Judas was a devil from the beginning. Jesus says in this chapter, he says, "I chose you 12, and one of you is a devil." He was talking about Judas. And then later, go ahead and look at John 17 and 12. Jump ahead to John chapter number 17. And verse 12. Jesus here is praying his great high priestly prayer. This is what I like to call the real Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, that's the model prayer. What we have here is the Lord's high priestly prayer. And in this prayer, Jesus says in verse 12, "While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me I have kept, and none of them is lost, but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled." And so the Old Testament foretold that Judas was going to betray Jesus. It foretold that he was going to betray him for 30 pieces of silver. Jesus calls the Judas a devil. Jesus calls Judas a devil. Jesus calls Judas a thief. Jesus calls Judas the son of perdition. You know, there's only two people in the Bible with the title the son of perdition. One is Judas, and one is the Antichrist. And so what we have in Judas is a wolf in sheep's clothing. What we have in Judas is an example of someone who says they are saved, but is not genuinely saved. We read in 1 John, "They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us." Judas' rejection of Jesus is proof that he was never saved to begin with. And so Judas cannot be used, nor can anyone who is a pretender, a false believer, a empty professor. No one such as Judas can be used to prove that a born-again believer can lose their salvation. And so getting back to John chapter number 6, we pick up there in verse 40, and Jesus says, "And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up again at the last day." So God's will is that everybody who sees Jesus, and we're not talking about physically, because we believe in this day and age without seeing. Let's talk about seeing through the eyes of faith. In the Old Testament, we are told in the book of Isaiah, "Look unto me and be saved, all ye ends of the earth." In the Old Testament, with the story we've talked about many times on this program, where the Israelites had angered God, and the Lord had allowed fiery serpents to go in and bite the people, and then the people repented. They went to Moses, and Moses went to God, and God said, "Make a serpent of brass, put it on a pole, and whoever will look at the serpent shall live." It's a look of faith. That's why we sing the song, "Look and Live." And so we read again, "And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son," and connected with that is, "and believeth on him." They're both one and the same. We are looking to Jesus Christ for salvation. We are looking to him in faith. We are clinging to him, relying on him, trusting him to be our Lord and our Savior. We are trusting in who he is, and we're trusting in what he has done. Shed his blood, died on the cross for us, and risen again. We're relying on the work of Christ and the person of Christ to save us from our sins. And that is God's will. You know, the Calvinists make a great deal about God's sovereignty and the will of God. And they think somehow that the sovereignty and the will of God must mean that God must have some mysterious unknown will, where he, for his own mysterious reasons, picks one person over another to be saved. That's ridiculous. The Bible reveals to us again and again and again that yes, God has a sovereign will, but he has revealed to us what it is. And we read it again. "This is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life." And my dear friend, everlasting is everlasting. If it could be lost, it could not be called everlasting life. It would have to be probationary life. And then he says at the end of verse 40, the same thing he said at the end of verse 39. In the end of verse 39, he says, "Raise it up again at the last day." And in verse 40, he says, "I will raise him up at the last day." Now let's shift subjects for a moment. You remember several lessons ago that we were discussing that in church history in the past, there have been Christians and even groups of Baptists that believed in what's known as a general resurrection. Now, this was real popular in the 1800s and right on into the 1900s. And those who believe in a general resurrection are those who would basically reject a literal millennium. The Bible teaches, if you take it literally, that in between the coming of Christ at the end of this age and the end of the world, there is an intervening period of 1,000 years in which Jesus Christ will literally sit upon the throne of David and rule the earth from the Temple Mount. Those of us who believe in a literal millennium, those of us who believe that Jesus Christ is going to return before that literal 1,000-year period of peace, we would be called premillennialists. And that is the biblical position. That is what the earliest Christians were. In the first century, in the second century, we know that's what they believed. And over the years, as the Lord tarried his coming, some Christians began to try to explain the millennium away in a different way. And so you go over a little over 100 years ago, most Baptists and a lot of other Christians believed in a general resurrection. They believed there would be basically no literal millennium. It would just basically be a period of peace that we would bring about by winning people to Christ. And at the end of time, in the end of the world, Jesus would return and he would resurrect the saved and the lost at the same time. And you would have a literal judgment day, a literal 24-hour day where Jesus would return and he would basically divide the sheep from the goats, as we're going to see in Matthew 25 when we get there. That's a whole separate judgment that has nothing to do with what we're talking about here. But that God would basically separate the saved and the lost in one final judgment at the end of the world. And that then we just go straight into the heaven ages. And those who believe that, and there's still a handful of Baptists who believe that. And by the way, if you are one of those Baptists who's a general resurrection Baptist, I love you. We can have fellowship. You still believe Jesus Christ is returning. I think you're wrong. I think history has proven you're wrong. But as long as those of you who have differing end time beliefs from me or from other people, listen, we need to have a lot of charity, especially in the area of the end times. As long as a person believes that Jesus Christ is literally returning to the earth, they are an Orthodox Christian. They have the fundamental belief down pat, and we should be able to have fellowship and not divide over that issue. But those who believe in a general resurrection, they would say, aha, you see it says the last day, the last day. Well, there's a number of things that's wrong with just saying, well, it says the last day, this must be it. Number one, it could just be talking about the last day of the church age. It doesn't necessarily mean the last day of the world. And not only that, but I personally believe that the last day is a reference to the day of the Lord. Now, in 1 Thessalonians chapter number 4, we have the description of the rapture, okay? And 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 spills on over into 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. There's no thought break there. And when you read 4 and 5 together as one thought, you get the idea very clearly that the day of the Lord begins with the rapture. Now, you get into the book of Revelation, and I just got through preaching on Sunday evening this past week on the passages in Isaiah about the day of the Lord. There, the day of the Lord is a time of judgment. It's a time of God's wrath being poured out on the earth, during Daniel's 70th week. And then as you read through Revelation, you get past the 1,000-year reign of Christ, and the whole earth is destroyed by fire. And look what we read in 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 10. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 10. We read, Peter wrote, "But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up." Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness? So get this. We are told that we're entering the day of the Lord when the rapture happens. We're told that, you know, the day of the Lord is going on when the wrath of God is being poured out during Daniel's 70th week. We are told that 1,000 years later, the earth is burned up. And here we're told that that happens during the day of the Lord. And so the day of the Lord, the last day, as Jesus refers to it here in John chapter number 6, is not a literal 24-hour day, but it is a dispensation of time. It is over the last day, the day of the Lord, is an age that's over 1,000 years long. I believe the day of the Lord is about 1,007 years plus long. And at the very end of it, yes, the earth and all of its works are going to be burned up. But it is in that day that the resurrection will happen, the first resurrection. And that's going to happen at the very beginning of the last day, the very beginning of the day of the Lord. And so I hope that that is not too confusing for you. Now look at verse 41. The Jews then murmured at him because he said, I am the bread which came down from heaven. Now, when it says they murmured against him, what that basically means is they did not believe him. In fact, they had reasons in their wicked minds for not wanting to accept what it was that he said. Now think about this for a moment. This is a group of people. Most of them were there and were fed by Jesus at a great miracle. He fed them with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. They were ready to make him king by force when they thought that they wouldn't have to pay taxes to Caesar anymore. They were ready to follow him wherever he went as long as he was fulfilling their physical needs, as long as he was, you know, providing them food like a supernatural vending machine. But now that he's saying, I'm the Son of Man, now that he's saying he is the spiritual Messiah who's here to forgive their sins, now that they realize that there is a spiritual commitment to be made, they're uncomfortable. You know, there's a lot of people who are happy to have religion as long as they get something out of it, you know, that pleases their flesh. But what they have here is a man who they're going to have to bow down and accept as their Messiah. And remember what Jesus is. He's a Nazarene. Let's keep reading and see what they say. Verse 41, the Jews then murmured at him because he said, I am the bread which came down from heaven. You know, when you start saying that you've come down from heaven, you're starting to imply that you are a heavenly being. And they did not like that. And we read in verse 42, and they said, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How is it then that he saith, I came down from heaven? And Jesus therefore answered and said unto them, murmur not among yourselves. Listen, they did not want to accept that Jesus was the Son of God. They did not want to accept that he was divine. They did not want to accept that he is, you know, the one who's going to officiate over the last day. I think they understood he's talking about a day of judgment here. And he's implying already, as he did earlier when he was talking to the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the Jewish religious leaders, that, hey, remember he told them everybody's going to resurrect. Not just the saved, but the lost. There's a day of reckoning coming. People don't like to hear that today, and they didn't like to hear that here. And so, because they knew he was from Nazareth, they, you know, weren't interested in seeking out the truth about the fact that, hey, he was actually born of a virgin. Hey, he was actually born in Bethlehem. Hey, he actually fulfilled all the requirements of the Messiah. You know, had they had faith, they could have asked these things and Jesus could have explained it to them, but they didn't want to believe it. They just wanted to take the idea that he was born in Nazareth and hadn't actually fulfilled that prophecy of being born in Bethlehem and run with it. And so they, you know, if a person does not want to believe on Jesus, they will find an excuse. They will cling on to, if a person doesn't want to believe, they'll cling on to whatever it is they can find that they think will justify their unbelief. And what it is it's pride and it's disbelief. They were too proud to believe that this humble carpenter from Nazareth could have come down from heaven and was the literal Son of Man, the Messiah, the Son of God. And because of their pride, because of their arrogance, they disbelieved him. I mean, that's a very sad thing. We're going to see that even at the end of this chapter, even a bunch of people who called Jesus, who called themselves disciples of Jesus, you know, in John 6:66, that's a horrible number, but look at it. We're not there yet. Look at John chapter 6, verse 66. It says, from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. You know, after this discourse on the bread of life, a lot of people abandoned him because of pride. There are people in this world, they don't mind accepting Jesus as a teacher. They don't mind accepting Jesus as a prophet. They don't mind accepting Jesus as a good man. They don't mind accepting Jesus as a good historical figure of some sort. But hey, you start insisting that he came down from heaven. You start insisting that he's the Son of Man from the book of Daniel that came under the Ancient of Days, the Messiah, the Son of God. That's when people get upset. That's when people reject him and turn away from him. But my friend, I want you to understand, it is true. Jesus Christ is the bread of life which came down from heaven. And if you will eat this bread, how do you eat the bread? It's not by taking the Lord's Supper or communion or some sort of sacrament, as some people call it. It's not a religious rite where you eat bread and drink the fruit of the vine. There is a Lord's Supper. One day we'll talk about it, but that's not what Jesus is talking about here. Jesus is talking about eating him, eating his flesh as the bread of life, and drinking his blood, as we shall see. What does that mean? It's not literal, it's spiritual. Jesus said that we do that when we come to him and when we believe on him. That's what it says in this chapter. If you will believe on Jesus Christ, if you will trust in him as the one that came down from heaven, the Son of God, the Savior, if you will believe on him, come to him and trust him, rely on him, believe on him as the Son of God, believe that he died on the cross for your sins, believe that he rose again from the dead, and from the bottom of your heart, ask him to forgive your sin and save your soul, and he will save you, and he will save you forever. Those of us who are saved, we also need to remember that Jesus is the bread of life. And we need to remember that Jesus' word is the word that saves. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And you know, some of the old manuscripts of ancient days said the word of Christ. Both, of course, one and the same thing. It is our job to share the word of Christ. It's our job to share the word of God. And Jesus said of the word, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Remember, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So let's share the word of God. Let's preach the word of God. Let's witness to people using the word of God. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord Jesus, I thank you so very much for these sweet, precious people. And dear God, I pray if there's anyone lost, that dear God, they would recognize their lost condition, be convicted by the Holy Spirit, drawn by God the Father, and that, Lord, you would shine your light upon them, and they may recognize that they're lost and call upon you from the bottom of their hearts to be saved. Lord, for those of us that are saved, I pray that we might be edified and built up and motivated to study the Word ourselves and be built up, and, Lord, to share the Word of God with others. Lord, thank you for loving us. Thank you for being available to us as the bread of life. Dear God, thank you for fulfilling the will of your Father. Thank you for the promise that since we belong to you, we will not be lost. Dear God, that is a great and glorious thing. I couldn't go on if it wasn't for that promise. I thank you, Lord, for it. Lord, I pray that you would help us all to be faithful and to follow you. Be with those prayer requests that are on our hearts, Lord. You know the needs. You know the unspoken pains and burdens. Lord, I pray that you would be with all of these. Forgive us of our sins. Have your will and your way in our lives. All these things we ask in your name. Lord Jesus, amen. For our final hymn, we're going to sing the first verse of 386. the first verse of 386. There is sunshine in my soul today, more glorious and bright than glows in any earthly sky, for Jesus is my light. Oh, there's sunshine, blessed sunshine, when the peaceful, happy moments roll. When Jesus shows his smiling face, there is sunshine in my soul. My friend, may God bless you. We thank you for being with us today on the Old Landmark Baptist Bible Trail. This is Thursday, so we got one more Bible Trail this week. And then Saturday, we'll take a Sabbath rest and have just a doctrinal study. And then we'll see you on the Lord's Day for our services here at Antioch Missionary Baptist Church. We love you. We pray God's blessings upon you. Lord willing, we'll see you tomorrow.